Thank you for joining on today's webcast on state and federal legislation impacting public pensions. My name is Hank Kim, and I'm the Executive Director and Counsel for the National Conference on Public Employee Retirement Systems. Today's program is part of our Center for Online Learning. The purpose of NCPERS Center for Online Learning is to provide remote continuing education to public pension trustees, staff, and other fiduciaries and stakeholders. Over the course of this webcast, we will discuss the impact of state and local elections of 2016 and preview anticipated state and federal legislation for 2017. Joining me today are two familiar figures from our past webcast, Bailey Childers, Executive Director of the National Public Pension Coalition, NPPC, and Tony Roda, partner at the law and lobbying firm of Williams & Jensen. Welcome to the both of you.
Thank you.
The format we will follow today is a moderated conversation with our two panelists covering select state and federal legislation. We encourage our audience members to participate by submitting questions for our panelists by sending an email to Amanda Rock. Her email address is amanda@ncpers.org. However, to ensure that we can cover as many topics as possible, we will hold all questions till the last part of the program. We have a lot to cover, so let's get right to it. And Tony, we'll start with you because I think the biggest news coming out of 2016 is the federal election and particularly the presidential election. So give us a little recap on the election and an overview of what you think is happening with Congress.
Sure, happy to do it, and thanks again. Happy to be here with Bailey and you as well, Hank. Surprising, right, to most, the election results. I think the House was never really in play, so the Republicans retained the majority of the House. They did lose seats, but they did not lose as many seats as people thought they would. Prognosticators. The Senate, very much in play, but the pieces did fall to the Republicans, and the Senate Republicans held their majority, 52-48, losing two seats. And then in the presidential, a surprising result in my view. I think most people didn't see it coming. I think people inside the Beltway in particular didn't see it coming. I think we need to get out there and talk with people. Mm. In the so-called flyover states. For purposes of state and local governmental pension plans, you're looking at a Congress that looks the same, a tighter margin with the Democrats and Republicans in the Senate and in the House, but Senate is really where the rubber's gonna hit the road, I think. And then we have a very uncertain, executive branch situation. So President-elect Trump continues to make noise and policy through Twitter. I'm recommending that all my clients look at Twitter for major policy announcements. But I say that, with some seriousness, yeah. Because that is his style. I don't think he's going to give that up when he's president. So I think, the proper channels, what we are used to dealing with in Washington, are going to be very different in 2017. And I think we all have to hold on and be flexible as to how we approach things. And I think also for state and local, I think you need to look at the regulators, because what we have, while we have the same situation in Congress, we have an entirely different makeup in the federal executive branch. And there is some flexibility with regard to how they want to interpret statute, as we've seen with the Obama administration. Republicans were quick to criticize overreaches, so we're going to see how this plays out on with the Republican administration. So we have to be very careful. We're going to talk a little later about some of the regulatory issues, but I think that's kind of the large 30,000 foot overview.
Great. And Bailey, at the state level, what's the lay of the land? Remind us what happened in the 2016 election. Were there any coattails from the federal elections, and what does that mean?
Sure. And again, thank you, Hank, for having us. Tony, great to be with you again. Let me start with a couple of places that maybe trended against the national outcomes. Maybe that will be a surprise to people. Kansas, for one. Kansas is a state that we've looked at a lot the last couple of years because of some tax policy decisions that have been made there, thus resulting in some tough budget decisions that they've made because their revenues aren't coming in like they want it to. So in the Kansas legislature this election, we actually saw moderate Republicans win back some seats against conservative Republicans. You know, I think as people finally saying, look, we're tired of these cuts to education and infrastructure and not having money to do any priorities for the state. So that's an interesting state to watch this year, is how that legislature will interact with the governor in Kansas. Nevada is another state that went completely different than a lot of places in the country. And you now have the Democrats controlling all of the chambers in Nevada. So that's a state that there may be some opportunity to do some proactive work on pensions this year. We've had some difficulty in the past with the papers in Las Vegas and the editorial boards, but we do have a more favorable legislative climate if we want to look at trying to stabilize the system in a good way, not in a way that undermines benefits for public employees. So those are a couple of states where the election results were favorable as far as potential for good pension policy. Yep. A lot of states were not, unfortunately. So Kentucky and Missouri are two that come to mind. Those states are now completely controlled by Republicans, and Republicans that have been pretty anti-pension in the past. Kentucky is a big concern. They've already moved right-to-work legislation and repealed prevailing wage and a couple of other bills like that over the weekend. And so they're, you know, one week into session and have already gone after working families pretty quickly. So Kentucky's system is unfortunately fairly poorly funded because of some decisions of the government in the past. And so, you know, the question is, are they going to do what they need to do and actually put resources into the system? Or are they going to say, nope, we can easily move to a 401k now that we have all three branches of government? So Kentucky, I think, will be a state that we keep a close eye on this year. Missouri, basically the same situation in Missouri politically for us. So the other couple of states that are a big concern because of the elections, Pennsylvania. Republicans gained a couple more seats in both houses in Pennsylvania. They had tried several times in 2016 to move. They'll kind of just do whatever kind of pension reform they can get through. They've tried a 401k. They tried a hybrid last year. Not clear what they'll do this year, but I expect them to be right back at it again, especially because they've got a couple more seats, so they probably feel a little bit more emboldened to continue to go after the pension system in Pennsylvania, which is unfortunate because, you know, reform was made by both parties, the workers and the state, a few years ago to put the system on a path to full funding. And as you know, that takes time. It's not something that happens over the course of one legislative cycle or two. So that's a state that I'm very concerned about, Pennsylvania, because of those gains. And then a couple of other states we were hoping to maybe get some favorable switches didn't happen. So Michigan has stayed just the same. In the lame duck session just at the end of 2016, they tried to move a 401k conversion for the public school pension system. That did not get through in lame duck. There was a big uprising among teachers and firefighters and other folks. So I that will go back on their agenda. We're expecting it to be introduced again this week, but we'll see if they really want to push for that in Michigan or again pursue other priorities. So those are a couple of the places that I think will be tough for us this year, just because elections either didn't go in a great way or just kind of left us with the status quo, which I think will make people feel like, well, this is the year to do it then.
So a couple of personal footnotes regarding two of those states. So regarding Nevada, when NCPERS had our public safety conference in Nevada, we actually had an editorial board meeting with the Journal Review. As you know, it's backed by Sheldon Edelstein, so very conservative newspaper. And the editorial director, or editor, I guess, wasn't, certainly a bleeding heart liberal. But you know, he gave us the time of day, and you know, we had a very pleasant back and forth for about 45 minutes. And so I was very surprised that we had that much time. And given sort of the lay of the land now in Carson City, maybe there, you know, just to support what you were saying, that maybe there is some opportunity for offensive opportunities in Nevada.
Yes.
And then in Kentucky. We'll probably talk a little bit more about this, but they went through a combination, or no, they actually did a cash balance plan a year or two ago.
They did for one of the systems, for the state system, not the teachers. And then last legislative session, so Governor Bevin was elected in an odd year in 15, and then in legislative session last year, he actually did fully fund the system and provide some extra money for the system rather than making any changes, whether that be moving, you know, onto a 401k for the state employees or moving the teachers into a cash balance or a 401k.
Right.
I don't have a lot of confidence that we're going to have that same outcome this year. I think that they were waiting. They had hoped in 2015 to take the state legislature, and they did not fully take the House. And so now that they have, we'll see. But I'm not hopeful.
Right. So, Tony, let's go back to the federal side. You know, remind us where we left off in 2016, some of the bills that were in Congress. And then what do you think is going to happen in 2017?
Sure. Good question. I mean, we left the 114th Congress, and our work could be characterized as winning defensive battles.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And I think that we're going to have to continue to win defensive battles in the next Congress. But as you reel back the Congress, you look at December 2015, that's when Senator Hatch, who's the chairman of the Senate Finance Committee, introduced his Puerto Rico Assistance Act, S-2381. And that bill contained two provisions that had nothing to do with Puerto Rico, but had everything to do with state and local governmental plans in the 50 states. And one was PEPTA. Mm-hmm. Folks out there know that well. It has been around since 2010. And that legislation would, for the first time, require state and local governmental plans to report their funded status to the Federal Treasury Department and report their status not just on their assumed rate of return, but to do it also on a Federal Treasury obligation yield curve. So their funded status is going to go from whatever that number might be. Say it's a well-funded plan at 85%. I mean, the recalculation will take it down to 60 or 65%. It'll be a dramatic change, and it really is legislation that we believe is not necessary, does not provide any useful data into the system other than headlines.
Right.
And the other provision was the annuity accumulation plan, which would be a new qualified pension plan for state and local governmental plans, qualified in the Internal Revenue Code, optional. But we feel it's being positioned as replacement to DB plans. And we're very concerned that it would not contain any survivor or disability benefits for public safety, very important. And that the replacement income is going to be much less than what you would get under a DB plan. So those two provisions were in the Hatch Puerto Rico Assistance Act. We're pleased to report that the Puerto Rico law was enacted without the provisions, and that two other pieces of legislation moved through the Finance Committee and were not vehicles for either of those provisions, one being legislation on retired coal miners with regard to health and retiree benefits, retiree pension benefits, and then the other was kind of a grab bag of provisions aimed at defined contribution plans. Some important provisions in there. Legislation moved through the Finance Committee, but again, PEPTA and the annuity accumulation plan were not included. The other major defensive battle that we won was on normal pension costs, and you probably remember the Dold Amendment, mm-hmm. Named after now former House member Robert Dold of Illinois. And his concern was that dollars were flowing from elementary and secondary education, and that those dollars were being used to pay back unfunded liabilities in pension plans. They were used for teacher salaries, but that a lot of it was being diverted into paying for more than what he defined as normal pension cost. The House of Representatives passed that legislation in 2015 as part of legislation to revise the No Child Left Behind Act. But we were successful in conference with the Senate, not including that legislation, the Dold Amendment. And then again, he introduced in 2016 freestanding legislation on that. So that legislation did not move through the process. So we were pleased with all of those battles on the legislative front. Now, in 2016, we face two major areas of federal legislative activity, tax reform and ACA reform.
You mean 2017?
2017, excuse me, in the new Congress, the 115th Congress. So what we're going to look at is tax reform, I've always said, is the ultimate catch-all legislation. So not only would PEPTA and the annuity accumulation plan be in play as part of that, but other areas could come into play that would affect state and local plans. You could look at contribution limits. You could phase out the value of contributions by high-income taxpayers. You could remove the catch-up provisions for those age 50 and over. You can also look at areas where governmental plans have a different set of rules, and some involve 457 plans, limitations on contributions, and there will be an application of 72T, the early withdrawal penalty. There's the pickup rule, which continues to be an issue out there with some plans pushing for flexibility in providing for an election to another plan or tier. That also is a federal tax code provision. So in the area of tax reform, we see a lot of potential issues that would impact us. And then on the ACA, so the Affordable Care Act, a tremendous political rallying cry, and now it's up to the Republicans to do the repeal and replace. And how is the repeal and replace done? And it's an issue that the Republicans are grappling with right now. And some say it's got to be done quickly. Some say we're going to repeal, and then we're going to replace over time. And that time could be maybe 2 to 4 years out. In the meantime, what do we do with some of the issues that we've looked at? One in particular, the Cadillac tax, the tax on high premium plans. So what are we going to do with that? Are we going to repeal the Cadillac tax early, right out of the box? But then what do we do with the revenue shortfall? Now, that may be easier because the effective date was pushed out to 2020. Mm-hmm. So, but it's all going to be on the table more than we've seen in recent political history. And with the Republican president willing to sign this legislation, the decisions made by Congress are very, very critical.
So I know it's only been a few days since this Congress was sworn in, but what are you gathering in terms of intelligence, in terms of priority of the two, tax reform or ACA, you know, repeal and replace? What is taking the priority here?
It seems to bounce around, to be quite honest, but ACA repeal seems to be a very high priority and an immediate priority. Begs the question, repeal and replace. So what are you going to do in this meantime? And you can repeal the ACA and not make that effective. You can make the repeal not effective for 2 years. Is that a big enough political victory for the president, president-elect still today, and the new Congress? I don't know. I've been surmising a little on this front that while you do the repeal on ACA quickly, you do the planning for the replacement, you have a vacuum there. And the committees that are involved are the same committees, right? House Ways and Means and Senate Finance. So what do they fill that vacuum with? My thought is they fill it with tax reform. They fill it with hearings, they fill it with process, and they try to get to a point where they're marking up a bill prior to the August recess. All the talk about tax reform, you know, it's still a long way from getting the members' buy-in. So it's going to take a tremendous effort to get there. But I think that may be how it plays out. But again, you know, it can change on a dime.
Sure. Mm-hmm. And in terms of tax reform, obviously, you know, the title's simple, but it has a number of things under the universe of tax reform. And so what are you hearing in terms of, you know, the current items that may be up for reform?
Outside of what we talked about a minute ago with regard to state and local,
The
big picture is trying to drive down the rates, right? Especially on the corporate side. Because, you know, the argument has been made, and I think many economists, most would agree, that we put our businesses in a situation where they're not competitive. And that the decision to move jobs overseas and production overseas has become more attractive. Mm-hmm. So I think that is going to be a major thrust in bringing that back into some degree of parity. So what the rate's going to be at the end of the day, I couldn't tell you. I don't think anybody could right now. But I think that's going to be a real driving focus of it. And also the corporate alternative minimum tax, which people believe doesn't even raise that much money anymore. And it's a very complicated additional step that businesses have to go through. That so that I suspect would be repealed.
So I mean, your guess and sort of conventional wisdom is that the engine that's driving the tax reform debate is really on the corporate tax. Right?
I would agree with that, but I would have to say that the Republicans politically will not allow just a corporate tax reform bill to proceed, and I don't think Trump would either. I think individual reform will have to accompany it, and that will be to drive down those rates as well.
Okay, great. So we'll get in further detail about 2017 at the federal level, but Bailey, in the states, you sort of gave the lay of the land. What are we anticipating, and what states are we anticipating legislation? And in terms of those rare events where we might have some offensive possibilities, what would those be?
Sure. So, you know, the interesting thing about 2015 and 2016 was at the state level, we saw states largely decide to stick with their defined benefit pensions. You know, they might have made some changes to them, but it was largely to shore them up and make sure they were going to be there and going to be able to provide benefits for current employees and new folks. So that was positive. We didn't see states deciding to get rid of pensions in the last two sessions. So that trend, I'm going to be interested to see how that continues. And then I think we talked about this at our last webcast, but we actually saw a couple of proactive measures pass in 2016. So Wisconsin expanded access to pensions for municipalities that didn't offer a pension. They were allowed to join the Wisconsin retirement system to provide better retirement for firefighters in Sun Prairie, Wisconsin, for example. And then you had Oklahoma create, for lack of a better way to describe it, a rainy day fund for its pension system that basically said, you know, here's a place, if we're in a good budget year, the government can put aside some extra money, and if we get to a bad budget year again, then maybe they use that to help pay the pension obligations that, you know, would relieve the current budget year a little bit. Or if we're in a couple of good years, they pay a cost of living adjustment. So those were some, you know, just interesting policies that we hadn't seen before, and that was exciting. It was exciting for us to see it and hope that maybe more states would do it, but I'm not sure. I'm not sure how much of that there will be. So some of the things that we're looking for this year, I kind of already mentioned Pennsylvania. I think Pennsylvania and Michigan are two that we'll watch, because the last couple of years they've tried the same types of legislation to move away from pensions. We expect they'll try it again. And so that's something that we'll be watching for. Texas is going to be an interesting state. So they're back in session this year. Texas, they're in session every 2 years for, five, 6 months?
Right.
And they're back in session dealing with primarily local pension systems. So Houston and Dallas. Dallas, people on this webcast have probably seen in the news, unfortunately. They've got some real funding problems in Dallas. What I'll say about Dallas, they're unique because their funding troubles are somewhat because of the fund manager and some activities that he did, which he's now, I believe, under investigation by the Texas Rangers, are looking into the Dallas pension system. So what I'll caution other pension systems in Texas is Dallas is not necessarily an example for the rest of them. Austin, Houston are not gonna have what happened in Dallas, because there are just some very extenuating circumstances. So I think that's important for people to realize is when you see the press about Dallas right now, they've got some very unique things that happen there that don't apply to most municipal pension systems.
Sure.
So that's important to remember. That said, the way that the state of Texas works, for municipalities like Houston, Dallas, and a handful of others, any changes to the system have to go through the state legislature. Now, that was designed to make sure that you have the workers and the city sitting down together to compromise on something, so you're not just saying, well, we're just gonna slash benefits for employees. They actually make the city and the employees work together. I think Houston has come up with a package that the pension systems feel good about and the mayor feels good about, and so they've got to move that through the state legislature. Dallas, I don't know that they have come to resolution yet, but I know that's something that we're looking at there. The other piece of this is that the Arnold Foundation is working very hard in Texas to take away that way that they do the legislation for the bigger cities in Texas. So they want to give local control, which means give the city back complete control over making changes to its system, and it would take away that kind of bargaining together to make a good faith effort. So that's something that we'll be fighting in the Texas legislature if it starts to move because like I said, the Arnold Foundation really is only doing that because they want it to be easier for the cities to make changes that are harmful to employees. What's funny about that is that in Nebraska, the Arnold Foundation is funding a lobbyist through another organization. And in Nebraska, they are lobbying to try to get the state to tell Omaha and Lincoln that they can no longer offer a defined benefit to their new employees. So I think it's just a good example how Arnold doesn't really care about local control or about, you know, who's making the policy. They're just trying to get rid of pensions. So I think that's an important point for those of you who might be in those two states to know. They're talking out of both sides of their mouth. All they care about is getting rid of pensions. So we'll continue to watch their activities in other states this year as well. Interesting thing that happened at the end of 2016 in New Jersey, of all places. Governor Christie signed a bill requiring quarterly contributions into the New Jersey pension systems. Whether or not he actually puts the money in is still to be determined, because that's been the problem in New Jersey. Is, you know, he'll agree to legislation to make the payments in theory and then just not do it. So New Jersey is one that we'll continue to watch because of the funding issues there, because of the state not doing it for so many years. Other places we're going to keep an eye on where Pew has been active are Alabama and South Carolina. So in Alabama, and I believe also South Carolina, cash balance is what they've been promoting there. And we know they've got lobbyists active on the ground. In Alabama, last session, there was a study commission that looked at the retirement system there. They decided not to move a bill, even though the cash balance was what they were recommending. We're going to keep an eye on that this session to see if they do go ahead and move forward. And then if so, you know, we'll work hard to defeat that. And same for South Carolina. We're waiting to see kind of what that bill is going to look like out of South Carolina. And then, you know, Kansas, what's interesting about Kansas, because of the change in the legislature, there are groups working to roll back some of the tax cuts that have been so damaging to the state budget there, including to the pension system. As you know, I think I talked about this last time, Governor Brownback was given the authority by the state legislature to use pension payment money to shore up a budget hole, and he still hasn't paid it back. It was originally due September 30th. They gave him an extension until the end of the fiscal year. Who knows if he pays it then, but I think our big concern is we don't want that happening again, where they say, oh, well, let's just not pay the pension this year and, you know, put this money somewhere else because we've got another revenue shortfall. Because as we all know, and I think the folks on this webcast know, when the state starts skipping its payments, that's how we quickly get into trouble with unfunded liabilities. Right. That is the way that we get down that path, is when the states stop making the payments they're supposed to make. So that's a big concern for Kansas, but I do think there's hope because you've got some more moderate legislators that I think are just tired of the continual cuts and the fiscal mismanagement of the state.
Great, great. So I'm gonna turn it over to Tony and talk in detail about some of the specific federal legislation and regulations. But before I do, I want you to think about five trends that you'd be looking for to see whether the year is gonna be positive or negative.
That's a hard one, okay.
Yeah. It doesn't have to be five, but things that you would look at and say, okay, you know, if it breaks this way, we're looking at something positive. If it breaks this way, yeah, we may be in some trouble.
Okay.
So Tony, tell us a little bit about some federal regulations and legislation specifically for public pensions.
Sure, I'll start on the legislative front.
Yeah.
And we already talked in some detail about tax reform, so I won't go over that again, but that's something we're gonna have to keep our eye on very closely, and the ACA as well. And the ACA could well carry some good things. I mean, to the extent that we're looking at, and I know NCPERS is looking at, helps too. Mm-hmm. So in 2006, in the Pension Protection Act, there was a $3,000 exclusion from a retirement distribution that could be used to offset health care premiums. And that was much heralded and very successful effort. And NCPERS is interested in expanding that beyond what it is today, which is just public safety, but to all public employees, indexing the $3,000 annual exclusion, and potentially turning it from an exclusion to a deduction, which would be even be able to be used by non-itemizers. So there's a lot in the weeds there, but I just wanted to say that NCPERS is kind of out in front in looking at offensive areas as well. And I'm very pleased to see that. The other, I think Social Security is something that we have to look at. I don't see major Social Security reform legislation. Mm-hmm. There are too many other major items that have to be dealt with in this Congress, but Once we get to that area of Social Security comprehensive reform, we're going to have to play defense on mandatory Social Security. Mandatory Social Security essentially is bringing everyone under Social Security. So the 25% of state and local governmental employees in the country that are not part of Social Security today under mandatory system over time would be, and that's all for new employees. That's why I say over time. So it's not a retroactive application, but we're looking at that rather closely. Short of comprehensive Social Security reform, we look at WEP, the windfall elimination mm-hmm. provision, and Ways and Means Chairman Brady, as you both know, has been very involved and committed to trying to find a solution to WEP. And he had a bill ready for markup, HR 711, in the last Congress, but it was pulled the day of the markup because there wasn't sufficient consensus on the legislation. But I know he'll return to that, and that's a major priority for him. The other thing we should look at before I turn to the regulatory front is the Puerto Rico Assistance Act, which I talked about early. We have to watch very closely the implementation mm-hmm. of it. And there are a couple of members of the Oversight Board who have, at least one, has had a longstanding critical view of defined benefit plans. So his voice will certainly be heard in the proceedings. Another member of the Oversight Board has proposed using federal bankruptcy law to allow states to get out from under pension obligations. Of course, that's not permitted under current bankruptcy law. So there are definitely folks on the Oversight Board who are going to keep this issue front and center. Of course, the situation with Puerto Rico's pension plans is not good. Mm-hmm. So a lot of study will be done as to how they got there. And alternatives, potentially, that's something else that the Oversight Board is charged with, which is providing alternatives to pension funding. So what is that going to take? What form is that going to take? So we're going to have to watch that very closely. On the purely regulatory front, we made great progress on normal retirement age, which has been an issue that's been around since 2007. And early in 2016, proposed regs were put out, which I think the plan community was very happy with in general. There's some questions around the margins, but overall very positive. And I think very few comment letters were submitted. So we're poised for final regulations, which haven't come out yet. And now we're down to how many days before mm-hmm. we have a new administration. So we don't know if that's going to be done in a final form before they leave or not. It would be nice. It would. And I don't think it would. That's not a regulation that will engender, I don't believe, any concern by the next administration. But if it's left waiting, when will they get to it? Mm-hmm. Maybe not ever. You know, maybe it's such a low priority that they don't get to it, and the proposed regs are just sitting out there for years. So that is a concern. NCPERS has been very active in the states on mm-hmm. the Secure Choice Plan, and successful in some states. And DOL has put out two final regulations now on the Secure Choice Plans, the state-run plans for private sector workers. States, one regulation, and then political subdivisions is the second regulation. Now, there is concern in the industry about that, in the financial services industry, about those regulations. So it's on the long list of those that could be affected by the Congressional Review Act. The question that everyone has on the Congressional Review Act is, where do you fit in the priority list? Because while it's expedited procedure to undo one of these regulations by using the CRA, you still have 10 hours of debate in the Senate. And you have a clock that's ticking as to how quickly you need to get these things done, which we talked about before we came on and hit somewhere in March. So where are we with all of these hundreds of regulations? Where does the Secure Choice fit into that? And is the Senate capable even of finding enough 10-hour slots to do these regulations? Because they must be done individually. The House last week, in the first week of session, passed a bill to be able to bundle these, to do them in mass. But we haven't seen that the Senate has a great appetite for that yet. The Senate has to pass that with a 60-vote mark. That's just a regular piece of legislation, right? It's not protected by any special rules. So the bundling legislation to amend the CRA is going to require Senate debate and a 60-vote threshold. So I don't see that becoming law. So I think you're left with this long priority ranking as to how you get these regulations that the Republicans want to target undone.
And just as a quick background, for those who may not be familiar with what the Congressional Review Act is, I'll summarize it if you want to add some points to it, which is it was a law that was passed, was it in the early 2000s?
It was a part of the contract with America.
Oh, 95 mm-hmm. or 94, which essentially allowed Congress to undo what are termed midnight regulations. So as an administration is leaving, and if they choose to enact what are termed midnight, last-minute regulations, then Congress has, I believe, a 60 legislative day window. Mm-hmm. It's either 60 or 90 day legislative day window to, on per regulation, disapprove of it. And so that's what the Congressional Review Act is. And while the secure choice regulations were issued and finalized in the summer of 2016, there have not been the full legislative days to come up to the 90 or 60 day window where that regulation would be safe. So that's why we're talking about the Congressional Review Act.
Exactly. I think that those are really the high points for legislative and regulatory issues that we're looking at right now.
So I do know we're getting some questions. Why don't we finish up with some of our prepared remarks, and we'll turn over to Bailey and talk about the five trends that you're looking at. And while she's doing that, Tony, I'm going to ask you to think about sort of five trends at the federal level that may speak whether it's going to be a positive or a negative year for public plans. So,
Here I go with my five. So I actually think watching what the federal government does is going to be really important for state and local plans this year for a couple of reasons. So one, a couple of the things Tony talked about that we've seen in the past, do they get more steam this year? And then there's also been some chatter about undoing some of the federal civil service protections and maybe going after the retirement systems of the federal government workers. I think that could have a big impact on what we see then following, maybe not this year, but in future years at the state and local level, if they decide to do it. Now, I have no sense if they're actually going to. It's just, stuff that's made of the paper, chatter.
Yeah.
And you know how that is. So I think that's one thing to watch is what does the federal government end up doing related to state and local plans. I think that, retirement security, whether or not people continue to see that as an important issue. I mean, if nothing else that this election told us, people are hurting economically. Mm-hmm. And I think retirement's a big piece of that, right? People are getting to 40, 50, and 60 years old and saying, wait a second, there's no way I'm going to be able to retire. I'm literally going to work until I die. Mm-hmm. And so whether or not we are able to go out and communicate with people and get them excited about retirement and talking about better ways to do it, as an important policy priority for the states, I think that's going to be something to watch in this year. If we have success, using that anger that's there over the economic situation people are in, well, let's actually do something about that and do something positive, which doesn't mean getting rid of pensions, but it means getting more people covered with better access to retirement, which I know you work on in the private sector. And then I think there are ways we could look at doing more of what Wisconsin did, expanding pension access to people who don't have it. Ballot measures may be an interesting place to watch this year. So ballot measures, there was some more progressive legislation that won on the ballot in states that even they may not have sent people to Congress that matched passing the minimum wage increases, for example. Yeah. Louisiana passed a ballot measure to create a rainy day fund for pensions, kind of different than what they did in Oklahoma, but providing a different kind of funding stream for extra resources for the pension system. So ballot measures could be somewhere that's worth us looking at to do positive, proactive things for pension systems in the states. Another one I want to watch is municipalities. And do we continue to see, the Arnold Foundation go after municipal systems, whether it's Houston and Dallas or Omaha and Lincoln? If we see that start to expand, that's a big concern of mine. I think if we don't see a lot more activity at the municipal level, I will be happy. But it worries me a little bit that they've started, you know, doing the lobbying. They're writing a report, I think, on every major system in Texas at the city level. So just stuff like that we want to watch. And then finally, I think looking at the press 401ks are continuing to get. I hope everyone saw the Wall Street Journal article at the end of the year, maybe it was the first week of the year, talking about the people who developed the 401k saying that they regret what it has caused as far as moving to be the primary system for retirement for many Americans when it was not intended to be. Mm-hmm. And I was really happy to see the Wall Street Journal say that, surprised. But I think, you know, continuing to see the kind of press 401ks get helps us in our argument that we've got to be doing better for people. We've got to preserve pensions. We've got to think about how we expand them and protect their funding sources and do right by people who work hard and should be able to retire.
Great. All right. Those are good hallmarks to
All
look
right,
at.
Good.
Yeah. Tony, how about...
Billy, nice job.
Yeah. What do you have for us, Tony? What are the five things that you would look to see what kind of year we're going to have?
I think we have to look at the 100 days, right? The first 100 days of the Congress and operating with the new president are going to be very telling. And it's easy to say, it's easy to be unified in the minority, quite frankly. When you're in the majority, your decisions really matter. And the three of us could have been developing different ways to replace the ACA, for instance, for the last 5 years. Which one's going to win, you know, when we're all in the majority together. So these decisions become very important, and members tend to dig in. So the level of cooperation, I think, in the first 100 days is going to be very telling as to how all this is going to play out. The second is what I've mentioned already on Puerto Rico. How does the Puerto Rico situation play out? What are the lessons learned, and how do they translate into the federal view of state and local plans? I know Puerto Rico being a very small slice, not a state, but still, I mean, I think it's going to be used rhetorically and maybe actually in proposed legislation as the model for state and local plans. The other is, what kind of approach do the executive branch, the new Trump administration regulators take? And is it an aggressive posture towards state and local plans? Is it a, you know, do no harm, you know, just let the ship continue to go as it's been going? Or do they look for areas where they could use the, you know, regulatory pen to make some changes and steer the ship, right, away from a DB model? The fourth is, how does the public safety community, and that's going to be part and parcel of all the work we do. President-elect Trump, one of the first union I think to back him was the Border Patrol agents, and then came the FOP. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, he has this political affinity, he should, toward law enforcement and public safety. And that's got to be something that we push forward in our discussions about maintaining secure retirement for public workers. And the final is, and it makes me laugh a little bit, but federalism and states' rights and the argument of local control and all of that is such an argument of convenience. When it fits your model of facts, then trot it out there. Now, a Republican Congress should pay more than that matter of convenience approach to federalism. And so that, I think, is going to be important to see how it plays out. I think Speaker Ryan very much is of the mind that, you know, state and local governments, you know, they should have their dominion. Mm-hmm. And we're Congress and we do a different set of issues. And but to see how that translates on real issues down the line is going to be very interesting.
Well, those are fine things to look at, too.
All right, thank you.
Well, so we're at 45 minutes. We have some questions. First one is to Bailey. Are there examples of successes against the Arnold Foundation? I think historically, but also more recently from 2016.
Yeah, sure. So here's what I'll say about the Arnold Foundation. You know, they've now, John Arnold, not just through the Arnold Foundation, but through a variety of ways that he spends his money, has spent over $50 million attacking pension systems across the country. He is very rarely successful. So the success story is almost always us, which is exciting. If I were him, I would ask myself why I can't get a better return on my investment, but that's okay. He doesn't have to ask himself that.
Right.
So I would say Alabama, for example, anytime Pew is in a state, they're there on a John Arnold Foundation grant. So they've re-upped with him. I think I mentioned that maybe on the first one of these we did last year. So they're now close to $10 million they've taken from Arnold. So when they go to Alabama and are pushing very hard for a cash balance, that's through the Arnold Foundation grant, and we beat them last year. South Carolina, Pew is going to be active this year, so you know, like I mentioned, that's a state that we'll watch. But on the whole, I would say that we're successful at defeating the Arnold Foundation. I would say that they are probably not happy with Houston from the last couple years. They pushed very hard and lobbied very hard to have the mayor of Houston move the firefighters, police, and municipal employees into a 401k, and he did not do that. So first off, the candidate that they were supporting for mayor did not win, and then the one who did not give in to the pressure from the Arnold Foundation, which was through the paper and through lobbying and through testimony to move to a 401k, and he didn't do it. So, and that's right in their home state, also my home state, unfortunately, of Texas. So, you know, that's beating them right there where they are, which I'm happy about.
Now, for folks who want more detail and maybe a web access, is there a website? I know you guys host one.
We do. So we host truthaboutarnold.com. That tracks all of his spending on anti-pension work all over the country, and it's through a variety of ways, right? So it's not always just through the Arnold Foundation. He may give directly to candidates. He may give to political action committees, super PACs, folks like that are doing more political activity. But then a lot is through the Arnold Foundation, and so the money he's given to Pew is from the Arnold Foundation. He's now giving to the Retirement Security Initiative out in California, who are the folks lobbying in Nebraska to have Omaha and Lincoln move away from a pension system. We beat them last year because they tried at the Lincoln City Council, and we beat them at that. So now they're trying at the state level. So we did have we have had good success beating Arnold. You know, what I'll say, if they're in your state, a key is making sure people in the state understand that it's a national effort to undermine retirement security and pensions. You know, they're not coming in with good intentions just for that state. They've got a specific agenda that they're trying to push, and they do it across the country.
Or more to the point, as you've advised Omaha, that let policymakers know that this is a non-resident entity coming into our own state or our own jurisdiction and mucking around.
That's right. A little harder in Texas, but again, we were able to, with good arguments about the systems being, you know, relatively well funded. They've done reforms in the past. The employees have taken cuts in the past. And the city should be wanting to provide a good retirement for its workers if you want to provide good city services. And so from a variety of our arguments, you know, we were able to beat them in Texas last year.
So to get further follow-up and get more detailed documentation, the website is truthaboutarnold.org?
.com.
I'm sorry, .com.
Yep. And they can also visit our website, protectpensions.org. We often write about Arnold, and we keep a blog where we look at what's going on currently in the states. So as stuff starts to move this legislative session in the states, we'll have continuous updates on our website as well. So truthaboutarnold.com and protectpensions.org.
Great. Next two questions are for you, Tony. First one is regarding the new administration. President-elect Trump hasn't really spoken too much about retirement security, but he has said some things about Social Security. And so what does that mean? Or if we were to read the tea leaves, what would that mean? And particularly as it relates to some of his nominees, is there further refinement of the tea leaf reading that we can gather about that? And then the second one is about age 55, Medicare for public safety.
Right, very good.
Can you speak about that?
So Trump has said very little about retirement. It was not, at least at the federal level, a driving political issue for the campaign. He talked about Social Security, and he drew the line in the sand on Social Security, right? We're not going to increase the wage cap. So we're not going to increase the taxation of workers to pay for Social Security. But then he also said that we're not going to affect benefits in a negative way. So that leaves us with the situation that we have today, essentially, right? We have too few money, when you extrapolate it out over years, you know, the fund is not going to have enough cash for benefits. So he's got to look at that and, you know, do they get to it, though, at any time in the 115th Congress? I don't think so, that big picture. But it could be an issue for the next Congress. Now, when he looks at retirement in that lens of we're not going to affect benefits, we should take that as positive for our plans. And I think what we need to do, again, a political move, but it's a real move, is put out in front the public safety community so that they, in fact, are the ones who are carrying the message on this issue to the president-elect, soon to be president. With regard to Medicare, and this is something at your conference in Las Vegas, Ohio Police and Fire Pension Fund, and I participated in that that panel. We talked about the potential of federal legislation allowing for an earlier buy-in to Medicare for public safety employees who have reached age 55. And what I can tell you about that proposal, certainly hasn't been introduced in legislation yet. There are drafts, there are talking points, and there's work being done to lay the groundwork on this with the public safety community. So in fact, I was in some meetings last week with public safety organizations where we laid out the idea, very much asking for feedback and input at this point. But it, you know, early age Medicare is not a new concept. Arguments that actuaries might make is you're bringing in a healthier subset of people to Medicare that could help overall with Medicare. There's been, of course, a Republican resistance to expanding Medicare, period. And in fact, again, Speaker Ryan, we'll look at him and for things he's said over the years, is kind of moving in the other direction, is kind of reformatting Medicare and how it works. So I think, you know, we're going to press hard and with NCPERS help on the age 55 Medicare to give it a voice in 2017, and we'll see if it can take root.
Great.
Can I add one thing on the Trump, the nominees? So the one that we're most concerned about, well, there's many, but one that we're concerned about is Betsy DeVos, who is nominated for education. So she comes out of the DeVos family in Michigan, and they are, so we've kind of got, we've got the Arnold Foundation. In Missouri, you have a guy, Rex Sinkfield, who funds a lot of anti-worker legislation and policy activity. In Michigan, it's the DeVos family. And the DeVos family's number one policy goal for 2017 is getting rid of public pension systems in Missouri, or excuse me, in Michigan. So that's at the municipal level, and then for the public school employees. And, you know, she comes out of the charter school movement and is a, you know, big into education reform. The Arnold Foundation has also put a lot of money into education reform. Again, knowing if you can get rid of pensions for teachers, that's a way to completely change our public education system. So we are nervous about that appointment because of the kind of activity they've done in Michigan, what they've prioritized in Michigan for this year, and then what it might mean for teacher pension systems across the country.
And if I might add to that as well, the issue that I mentioned earlier, the normal pension cost issue, and the fact that it was tied to the elementary and secondary education, that could be an area for mischief by the new Department of Education and the regulators there.
Well, I think that those are the questions that we have time for. I will add in closing that both Bailey and Tony will be joining us for our legislative conference, which is going to be later on this month. It will begin on Sunday, January 29th, I believe is the date, which is Sunday. And then they'll be doing a full day, be part of the program for the full day briefing on Monday, January 30th. And then this new wrinkle to our program for the legislative conference is we NCPERS has scheduled a select number of Hill visits on Tuesday, January 31st. And so for the first 60 folks who sign up for that, they'll be joining myself, Tony, and some of our colleagues as we visit the tax writing committees of both chambers as well as the Senate Select Agent Committee to talk about public sector pension plan. So hopefully folks who are tuning into this webcast are already registered for the legislative conference to get more detailed information on the topics that we touched upon today, as well as what is the most important part about the legislative conference, which is to go visit your member and their staff on Tuesday the 31st. So again, thank you very much, both of you, for helping to inform our members on what to expect for 2017. And I suspect we'll be seeing each other again in mid-July as we do a recap of the first half of the year.
Sounds great.
To our audience, thank you so much for tuning in, and we'll have a next webcast, legislative review webcast in mid-July, and our regular monthly webinars beginning in February. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.